Good morning, River City Christian. If you have your Bibles, would you please open them up to Matthew chapter 4, verse 25? I'd encourage you, if you don't have a Bible out, to just get one out anyways and open it up to try to create as much normalcy in these weird times as possible. If you don't own a Bible in your home, you can always just use your phone. There's Bible apps that you can download. Matthew chapter 4, verse 25. Now, it looks like the coronavirus and its effects are going to just be with us a little bit. And I felt like it was super important because of that to just kind of jump back into a series that we've been in all the way in the middle of January to create as much normalcy as possible. So we're going to just jump right back into Matthew, walking verse by verse by verse through it as much as we possibly can. For I really do believe that it's God's word, and God's word is timeless. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And no matter what we face, I still believe as we walk verse by verse through Matthew, it's going to say a lot to us in these difficult times. Now, if you are new, or maybe you haven't been with us for a little bit, as a quick reminder of what Matthew is doing in this gospel, Matthew writes this gospel to his fellow countrymen to prove to them that the fulfillment of the kingdom of God is here. He is trying to prove to them that the fulfillment of the kingdom of God is in Jesus Christ as the Jewish Messiah, the Messianic King, that the entire Old Testament points to. Again, as we unpack Matthew, there's some beautiful stories, wonderful verses, meaningful things to our life. But in the end, it really is a 28-chapter argument that Jesus is the Old Testament Messiah. Now, today we make quite a bit of a big transition. We've taken some time and we've unpacked the first four chapters of Matthew. And now we move into Matthew 5, 6, and 7, which has traditionally been called the Sermon on the Mount. And the transition we're making is Matthew has been arguing from the Old Testament. Essentially, look at these prophecies fulfilled in this one man, Jesus. He was born in Judah, specifically from the line of David, born in Bethlehem, out of Egypt, called a Nazarene. These prophecies of Jesus go on and on and on. He's saying, look at the Old Testament prophecies, Jesus is our guy. But he makes a transition from that argument to look at Jesus's present day existence, specifically displaying for us his teaching, miracles, and ministry that also show us by what he said and did that this is our guy. For as it says in the last verse of the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 7, it says, when Jesus had finished saying these things, when he had stopped teaching, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he had taught as one who had authority, not as their teachers of the law. In other words, this guy has fulfilled Old Testament prophecies over and over and over again. He might be the one, but now we see him in real time teach in a way that we've never seen or heard before. He must be our guy. Now, as we move into the Sermon on the Mount, these three chapters, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, really can be kind of a sermon series in of themselves. They kind of stand alone. In fact, these three chapters are possibly the most important three chapters in the entire Bible. Why? Well, number one, what we have in the Sermon on the Mount is Jesus's correct interpretation of the Old Testament. Remember, Jesus said, I did not come to abolish the law. I've come to fulfillment. And so we get an interpretation of the Old Testament, specifically the law, from Christ. Think of it this way. If you were going to do an Old Testament study of the law and you were going to go out and buy some commentaries, wouldn't it be smart to start with Jesus's commentary on the Old Testament? See, what we're going to see in these three chapters is almost every passage that Jesus teaches from, almost everything that he addresses, finds its source in an Old Testament passage. The second reason why it could be the most important three chapters in all of Scripture is because everything written after Jesus by the apostles finds its source really in these three chapters. Another way to say it is this. If you want to understand the New Testament, a good place to start is understanding these three chapters. And then thirdly, essentially what we have in these three chapters is what Jesus is all about. It's a manifesto of a new king. Jesus has come to earth and it's like his inaugural address of what he and his kingdom is going to be about, especially who he and his kingdom is in contrast to the religious leaders and what they have been teaching. For he is going to usher in a new age with an incredible new message and what it truly means to be a follower of God. And so with that said, to understand what Jesus is addressing and why he says what he says, I think it also helps to understand who is in the audience. Matthew chapter 4, 25 through 5:1, these verses give us some clues that allow us to make an educated assumption of who's in the crowd. So if you're with me, Matthew chapter 4, verse 25, it says this. Large crowds from Galilee, which was the outskirts. So it's outside the city, countryside, Jews were there. It then says, from the Decapolis. These were most likely pagan Romans. Then a very important one, and it goes very simply says, from Jerusalem. And the reason why this was a bit significant is because Jerusalem was nowhere near where Jesus is teaching at the time. And so some people are there listening to Jesus teach, but they've made an effort to be there. So who are these urban Jews from urban Jerusalem? Well, most scholars would argue this is the religious elite who have intentionally come, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and very likely the Zealots as well. It goes on to say there are people there from Judea, which was the surrounding area, which definitely could have included some of the disciples who have yet to be mentioned. And then it says beyond the Jordan. That's kind of like the other side of the tracks. And this is where a religious group called the Essenes would have come from. The point is Jesus at this point has gone viral technologically, if you will, in our day and age. Scholars estimate there could have been up to 10,000 people there, drawing pretty much from everywhere, therefore drawing from every type of Jew. But specifically, what I want you to catch is the religious elite are in the crowd checking Jesus out. They've obviously heard about him. There's momentum. There's a crowd growing. And so they have come out curious who he is, what he's teaching, what side is he supporting, and what kind of crowd is going to be following him. And so then it says this, chapter 5, verse 1, moving into the next chapter. Now, when he saw the crowds, and I think that's significant. It's not just about he saw a bunch of people. I think he saw the religious leaders in the crowd. So when he saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside, sat down, his disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying. So what's happening here? Well, specifically, obviously, you've got thousands of people. He then brings the disciples to him, and he begins to teach. Now, he's teaching the disciples. In Matthew chapter 4, 23, it says he was going through the synagogue's teaching of the kingdom of God. And so Jesus has given them a new understanding, a better perspective of what the kingdom of God is really about. And this is super important because the disciples, after Jesus leaves, will be filled with the Holy Spirit, and they're going to usher us, the church, into the new age. And so it's important they understand what the kingdom of God is. But as he teaches them, basically in contrast to what the religious leaders have been teaching, he's doing so in earshot of the religious leaders. And it's very intentional. As we're going to see in the next few months, he's specifically pointing out the misinterpretations and mistakes of the religious leaders who are listening. In front of everybody, they've all there, they all know it. He's really calling them out. It's kind of his first shot across the bow. So with that understanding, what's he addressing? I think there's two really important contexts that we have to read the Sermon of the Mount in that allow it to kind of have more meaning for us. The first context is the political context. It's vital to understand what Jesus is addressing. Now, when I say political, I don't mean it like how you and I may interpret that, you know, Republican, Democrat, voting democracy. That's not what I mean. I mean it from a national perspective, nation against nation at the time, who the Israelites expected to be politically in the world because of the promises of God. I kind of laid this out a little bit more on Palm Sunday, but by the time Jesus had come, the Jews were living in oppression for centuries, but yet at the same time, they were still longing, waiting, hoping. They were looking for the promised Messiah. But what kind of Messiah were they expecting? I mean, even the disciples, I laid it out. When Jesus died, they were shocked. They were all looking for and expecting a conquering hero to restore Israel, a new king that would usher in a new kingdom that in this kingdom, the Israelites would be a part of and then rule over the earth. Now, there's a good reason why they thought this. Again, if you look at the Old Testament, there's a ton of Old Testament prophecies speaking of this conquering, powerful Messiah who will bring with him a new physical, powerful kingdom. But what they missed was the kind of in-between king and kingdom. I've talked about this before as I've laid out Old Testament prophecies of Messiah. There was two sets of prophecies. There, as we would say as Christians, there was a first coming and a second coming of the Messiah. The second coming is what Revelation is all about. We're still awaiting. Jesus is going to come back, the conquering hero, and restore all things. But the Old Testament obviously talks about a first coming. This is the suffering servant, the one who would take up our iniquities and die on a cross. I've showed you a picture before of a kind of a man. There's two mountains, And from the perspective that he has, it looks like it's one mountaintop. I've actually experienced this in my life. I'll never forget. I was hiking above Huntington Lake outside of Fresno in the Sierras. We're going to Kaiser Peak. I don't know, it's about 8,500 feet or so. And I remember seeing the peak and thinking, man, I'm tired, but we're almost there. And I remember cresting this one little mountaintop and realizing we still had another valley to go down before we actually started climbing the peak. And it was a little discouraging. I thought it was one peak, but there was a little time in between. This is the two sets of prophecies. You have the first coming of Jesus, a suffering servant, but then there's a valley in between until there's a conquering hero to come. Now, we can't blame them so much, right? I mean, if you're living in oppression, if you're hurting, if you're having difficulty, which one are you going to look towards? A suffering servant who's gonna die, or one who's going to be a conquering hero? And so they lean into the second, but they miss the first. And so in the first coming here in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is explaining to them what he's all about. And he explains that he's more concerned about what's going on in the inside than the specific do's and don'ts of the Old Testament law. See, the Old Testament was first interpreted really only about what you do and don't do. And as long as you acted correctly, what was going on in the inside really didn't matter. Therefore, it was actually thought that you could attain sinlessness. The idea that if you didn't do certain things and did the right things and then also sacrifice correctly, you could earn your way to heaven. Well, now Jesus comes on the scene, especially here in the Sermon on the Mount. He's telling them that you're more sinful than you could ever possibly imagine. And the reason why is because motives do matter. Your heart does matter. What you're thinking or why you're doing good things does matter. And what he really does in these three chapters is up the ante. As a quick example, the Old Testament law, and Jesus addresses this in the Sermon on the Mount, the Old Testament law says, do not commit adultery. Well, adultery, rightfully interpreted, is don't have sex with someone that's not your husband or wife. Don't do that. And so they thought kind of an Old Testament interpretation, if I just don't do that, then I would be considered in that area sinless. And what Jesus says is, yeah, you shouldn't do that. To physically commit adultery is incredibly harmful and it has grave consequences in this life. But if you think if you just don't do that, that somehow you're achieving sinlessness, you're far off, because if you look at another person lustfully, you have still sinned. Well, now there's no way to succeed because it's not just about what you do and don't do, it's also about what you think. And so in light of that, he ushers in a new kingdom where everything's upside down because there's no way to be perfect because the heart matters. Therefore, we're constantly in sin in need of salvation. The second context that he teaches within that's important to understand is the religious context. He's speaking into people I've already mentioned that are there, four Jewish theological and religious groups. Now, I don't have time to unpack it all. It comes 150 years before Jesus came onto the scene. The Maccabees come in. They push out the Seleucid Empire. They have this victory. And out of that, kind of these four religious groups splinter out over the next 150 years, the Pharisees, Sadducees, Essenes, and the Zealots. Again, most of you are probably not unbelievably concerned about the differences, other than to say that the dominant message that we'll deeply explore in these next few months is that we must not just see ourselves as holy because we do good religious things. That's what was being taught. See, spiritual disciplines are incredibly important. The Bible, even in the New Testament, tells us to engage in spiritual disciplines such as reading scripture and prayer, obedience, tithing, fasting, serving, engage in spiritual disciplines, but the mindset must be different. We can't engage in spiritual disciplines because we think we're going to earn something, earn salvation, earn love, or make us even look better than somebody else. That's not the purpose of the spiritual disciplines. Once we give our life to Christ, we are saved. There's no way we can earn that. But he gives us the spiritual disciplines once saved so that when we engage in them, the Holy Spirit then comes and meets us in those spiritual disciplines, and then he develops in us spirituality, helps us become more like Christ. Here's the key. Here's where I'm going. The foundation of Jesus' sermon, again, which is an accurate interpretation of the Old Testament, the beginning of the New Kingdom, and then the foundation of the apostles' letters. The foundation to Jesus' sermon is these external things must flow from a right internal life. I'll say it again. What he's really saying is these external things must flow from a right internal life, attitudes and character, if we're gonna truly be able to please and serve a holy God. It's how it's always been. I guess that's the point I'm trying to make. It's not a new thing. It was in the Old Testament from the beginning. It was just misinterpreted. For God said in the Old Testament, the Lord does not look at the things that man does. Man looks at the outward appearance. It looks at how we look, if we're strong, if we have authority, if we have wealth, if we do the right religious things. But he goes on to say, but God looks at the heart. Or as I just read in my personal devotions over the last few months as I walked through Psalms, Proverbs, and Ecclesiastes, and it says it multiple times in a bit of a different way, but it says, to do what is right and just is more important to the Lord than sacrifice. What that means, sacrifice, meaning, you know, blood sacrifice or religious activity. What he's saying is living as God has asked us to live with a right heart is more important than doing all the right religious activities. And so in light of all that, what is the purpose of the Sermon on the Mount? Because it's absolutely vital. The Sermon on the Mount does three very important things. The first thing that Jesus does in the Sermon on the Mount is shows our need for salvation. That no matter how perfect that we think we are, how good we are at religious activities, we still have a heart problem. We need a savior. This is why Jesus says in the Gospel of John, you need to be born again if you're gonna have anything to do with me. You need to be born again if you're gonna have eternal life. And of course, Nicodemus is like, what, born again? I even was made fun of very recently, and I won't go into the specifics just in case the person is watching, but kind of making fun of me for being a born-againer. But the concept of being born again is these new standards are impossible to meet without the help and power of the Holy Spirit working in our lives. It's not about guilt. It's understanding that his holiness is impossible to achieve. Yet, even though that's true, he offers forgiveness to those who seek it. And in the meantime, if we allow him to, the Spirit of God will help us become more like him. So number one, the purpose of the Sermon Mount is to show our need for a savior. Secondly, it shows our only hope for holiness is in Jesus. The Sermon on the Mount is intended to drive the listener to Jesus as our only hope for righteousness. Listen, people, if I've lost you along the way, at least listen to this one moment. By the power invested to me by a holy and almighty powerful God through his word, I hereby relieve you of trying through mere human effort to be acceptable to God and others. Let me say that again. The word of God, Sermon on the Mount, relieves you of trying through mere human effort to be acceptable to God and others, for it is impossible. But when we begin to try to meet those same requirements through the power of Jesus, although we'll never fully experience them, no way to fully attain them, we cannot find perfection here on earth because we all fall short. What the passage teaches is that God is concerned with the heart, and so he will bless your heart, he'll bless your effort, motives and desires, and where we fall short, he covers the rest of the way in his righteousness. So number one, the Sermon on the Mount as a collective whole shows our need for a savior. None of us can do it. And then when we need to lean into him for righteousness. And then thirdly, Jesus' wisdom contradicts the world's wisdom. What he does is he teaches an upside down kingdom. We've talked about that before. The world teaches a specific way that to find success and happiness. And Jesus says that will never bring true fulfillment. It will always leave you wanting. Do it my way and you can be blessed, he says in the passage. All right, let's dive into the first few verses and see what he has to say. Again, reading from Matthew chapter 5, verse 1 and 2, he says this. Now, when he saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them, saying, now, the first thing I want you to catch is he says it sat down. It's actually incredibly important. A rabbi would commonly teach by sitting. In fact, if a rabbi was standing or walking, what he said was considered informal and unofficial. But when a rabbi would sit to teach, it was communicating. What he was about to say was important, authoritative, and official. So again, setting the scene, there's a large crowd, who knows how many thousands. Amongst them, it says Jesus saw the religious leaders. With them in sight, he sits down to teach. And by doing so, he was communicating what he was about to say carried great weight, and he was claiming authority. Now, as he begins to teach, the first thing as you look at the passage is what many would call traditionally the Beatitudes. Now, the Beatitudes are not called Beatitudes because they're attitudes that start with the word blessed, so it starts with the letter B, so we say Beatitudes. It actually comes from Latin. The Latin word for happiness sounds very similar. Now, as we dive in, we see it says blessed are. Many of you are familiar with this passage. It says, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the meek, blessed are those who are hungry and thirst. It goes on, blessed are those. What does the word blessed mean? It's an interesting biblical word. It's not used very often, and it's reserved to explain an inexplicable joy that comes through participation in the divine kingdom. It's an inexplicable joy that we experience. Blessed are those who are diving in, participating in the kingdom. It's not simply do these things and you'll be happy and have a great life. It's the idea that when you allow the Spirit of the living God to lead you in these attitudes, over time as they're developed, you will get an incredible sense that you're right with God. And as you grow in being right with God, we experience an inexplicable joy, a blessedness that nobody else is able to experience apart from participating in the kingdom. So blessed, an inexplicable joy in participating in the kingdom of God. Now, the reason why I've included verses 3-4 in the intro is, number one, they're greatly connected to they're greatly connected to each other. But secondly, this is like an inaugural address for Jesus. He's beginning his ministry. In these first two, blessed are the poor in spirit and blessed are those who mourn, are really the entry points to his kingdom. So it's a beautiful place to start in an intro that if we want to be blessed, experience an inexplicable joy in his kingdom, we have to engage in being poor in spirit and mourning because that is the entryway into his kingdom. Let me explain. He first says, blessed are the poor in spirit. What does that mean? Well, simply put, it's to recognize one's spiritual poverty apart from God. It's to see oneself as we really are. We're lost, hopeless, and helpless. Apart from Jesus, every person is spiritually destitute. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter how successful in this life you have been. It doesn't matter how powerful you are. Apart from Jesus, it doesn't matter your education, wealth, social status, accomplishments, or religious and biblical knowledge. You are destitute. We don't have what it takes to be holy on our own. Another way to say it is you see yourself as you really are, a sinner in need of a savior. And it's from that place of humility or poor in spirit that you can say, God, I need you. It's the only way to start a relationship with God, to be able to finally be humble enough that you can say, I've tried every avenue. I've tried to control my life. I've tried to do it my way and it doesn't work spiritually. So now I submit to you. And then it goes on to say, when we are poor in spirit, when we come before God and say, I am in need of a savior, for theirs is the kingdom of God. The only way that we can enter into salvation is to finally admit our need for a savior. Listen, you cannot be a Christian without humility. We all struggle with pride on one level or another, but humility is the foundation to all things Christ. And the reason why is we enter into a relationship with Jesus by first saying, I can't do it on my own. Can't do it on my own. You know, a lot of times the world would say Christians think we're, you know, better than others or holier than thou. And that's really the opposite. Christians are people who have actually realized we can't do it on our own, that we are sinners in need of a savior. We're the sick in need of a physician. That's the power of it, being poor in spirit. It starts with humility. Then verse 4, it's greatly connected, says this, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. In our vernacular, if you just translated it word for word, it literally is happy are those who are sad. Talking about backwards. What in the world does that mean? Blessed, an inexplicable joy in participating in the kingdom of God. Blessed who are mourned is speaking of what the Bible calls godly sorrow. Godly sorrow is all over the New Testament. It doesn't mean being sad for sad's sake, and it's not speaking of asceticism. If you don't know what asceticism, it doesn't exist much anymore in our culture, but for hundreds of years, centuries, the idea was that because of my sin, I need to participate in Christ's sufferings. And so you would literally create physical harm to yourself. People may whip themselves, bite themselves, hit themselves, or maybe even emotional pain that somehow that would then make me more godly. It's heresy. It's nowhere in scripture. The idea that the more pain I have, the more godly I am. Now, it's not what it's talking about. Godly sorrow is mourning because you desire to be all God wants you to be because you love him so much and you recognize what he has done for you is died on the cross, yet at the same time, in light of that, you recognize you will fail. And so there's mourning. Paul says it this way in 2 Corinthians 7:10. He says, I love this equation. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. Look at that equation. It starts with godly sorrow, or as Jesus says, blessed are those who mourn. Mourn. We see what we have done. We see our sin, and because of that, we are sorry, so we repent. Repent is saying, I'm sorry, and then asking God to help us turn from it. Then we receive salvation, and then it leaves no regret. You don't have to worry about all the sin that you've done before. He goes on to say, see what godly sorrow has produced in you. Look at its positive results. It's created earnestness, eagerness, indignation, concern, and a readiness to see justice done. Translation, the only sorrow that brings about spiritual life and growth is godly sorrow. And that's not beating yourself up over and over and over again because of sin. It's that we recognize we hurt a loving God through our disobedience, and because of that, we're sorry, we repent. And what scripture's saying here, what Jesus is saying, is that kind of sorrow, that kind of pain, that kind of mourning, coming before God, I am sorry for my sin, will be comforted. For at the end of that kind of mourning is mercy, restoration, forgiveness in the loving arms of our God. So let me kind of just recap before I move on. What the Sermon on the Mount collectively does is that, number one, it points our need for a Savior. I mean, it gets to the heart. It's not just about physical action. Even our heart can be wrong. We all need a Savior. Then he says the only hope for righteousness is Jesus. It's leaning us into him, that he will bless our heart, our desires, our motives, and where we still fall short, his righteousness takes us the rest of the way. And then he's turning the world upside down and says, you want fulfillment, you want blessedness, which is an inexplicable joy that comes from participating in the kingdom of God? Well, let me share it with you in the Sermon on the Mount. It starts with being poor in spirit and mourning, humility and godly sorrow, confessing sin. So how can we begin to achieve this kind of humility? A couple things. Number one, we got to get our eyes of ourselves and get our eyes on Jesus. If we're going to find any success in achieving humility, it starts here. See, part of the problem in modern Christianity, American Christianity, is far too many people come to Jesus, not for him and on his terms, but for themselves and what they want to get out of it. And because of that, they pick and choose from scripture what they're going to obey and what they're not. But here, that's not true humility. That's not being poor in spirit. Being poor in spirit, true humility is coming to the word of God openly and saying in prayer, whatever you say, God, I want what you want. Even when I don't fully understand, even when I don't like it, even when it's hard, help me, God, do it your way. That's where it starts. Secondly, if we want to develop this kind of humility, we must take a step back and regularly have an honest inventory of what feeds our pride. What feeds your pride? Praise, compliments, popularity. You know, what are the motives for what you do? And we have to be careful, because I think encouragement to one another is important, and it's okay to feel good over things that we've accomplished, but there's a danger zone. I mean, even in scripture, Satan, or the scriptures talk about how Satan is a genius and he will often use our best intentions to his advantage. And we have to be careful to not even allow humility to become something, if you can believe it, that we're proud of. And so we have to regularly do an inventory. Okay, what's feeding this pride? But lastly, and I think really most importantly, we're all human. And so if we're going to develop this godly humility, we have to recognize it's beyond us. And so what we must do is ask for it. Come before the Lord and say, Lord, help me have humility. Help me have the spirit that you asked for in the Sermon on the Mount of being poor in spirit and mourning over sin. King David said it this way, create me a pure heart, renew a steadfast spirit within me. I love how James said, if any of you is lacking wisdom, and later he even talks of humility, and he will lift you up. But if you're lacking it, ask for it and I will give it. I really do believe God is more willing to dispense humility than most people are willing to ask for. How can we measure how we're doing? A couple things. How can you measure how you're at and with being poor in spirit and mourning? Well, who do you think of most, yourself or others? And the best way to really answer this question is not really even kind of gauging what your thoughts are about, but where are your actions? You know, do you spend the majority of your time serving others or serving yourself? Secondly, do you find yourself constantly complaining about your situations and circumstances? See, when we complain, it really does reveal something. The more we complain, it reveals a deep-seated belief that you deserve. There's something down deep that believes you deserve, and when that's not happening, that's where complaints come from. Listen, none of us like what's going on right now, but we find ourselves having more complaints coming out of our mouth and praises of God. It's showing something down deep inside of you. And then really lastly, are you accepting Jesus on his terms, or are you trying to create your own? Again, I already said it, but so many people try to accept Jesus for salvation's sake or to fix a specific problem, but then you want to hold on to your past, do it your way, pick and choose from scripture what you obey. Essentially, you want your own kingdom. And Jesus simply says, it's mine or yours. Choose. Mine or yours. You cannot serve two masters. Mine or yours. So it starts there, being poor in spirit, saying, I'm a sinner in need of a savior, and then mourn over that sin. And he says, then the kingdom of God is yours, and you will be comforted. Again, what are the results? Those who come to the Lord, I love this sentence, those who come to the Lord broken over sin do not leave with broken hearts. I need you to hear that. Are you hurting today? Are you broken today? I promise in some way, sin is a part of that equation. Those who come to the Lord poor in spirit and mourn, the kingdom of God will be theirs and they will be comforted. Those who come to the Lord with broken hearts will not leave with broken hearts. We will be refreshed, clean, whole. I love the way Isaiah says it in chapter 6 of his book. Woe to me, I am ruined, for I'm a man of unclean lips. He was broken. He falls to the ground in complete humility, poor in spirit, mourning over his sin. And what's God's response? Your guilt is taken away. Your sin is atoned for. As I close, I guess I need to address two groups of people. The first amongst us are people that have never given their life to Christ. And I'm hoping you see the gospel here, what it's really about. It's not do's and don'ts. It's not earning your way into heaven. It's not achieving. Christianity is not about the next good thing that you're supposed to do so that somehow you're better than somebody else. That's not what it's all about at all. Jesus, as he brings in a new kingdom in his inaugural address, said, you all need a savior. And the only hope for righteousness is me. And so my encouragement to you is to just let go of all the trying, all the hard work, all the achievement that you're trying to make to be acceptable to God and maybe to others, let it go. Become to him humble. I'm in need of a savior. Mourn over your sin, and the kingdom of God will be yours. You will be comforted. And so all in this moment, you can just simply say, Lord, forgive me of my sin. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. And the kingdom is yours. Salvation is yours, and he will comfort. The second group of people I feel like I need to address are the rest of us, probably the majority of us checking us out today, and that's Christians. I've been saying this from the beginning of this crisis that we're in. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says that when my people come to me, when they come to me and they pray, I will hear them and I will heal them. But it's all contingent on this one really important moment where he says if they repent. And again, I think it's us. We need to lead the way. And so wherever you're at today, whatever's going in your life, I think it's important to do some inventory, that we look to the Lord, that we have all this time on our hands. Let's take some time, an hour here, an hour there, to get right with God, that you do an inventory. Look at your life. Point out, let's say, five things in your life that are not in tune with him. Be poor in spirit. Be humble about it. Mourn. Have godly sorrow. Come to him and repent. Ask for forgiveness. Ask for restoration. Again, going back to Paul's sentence, godly sorrow leads to repentance, but here's the beauty. It leads to a salvation and leaves no regrets. That you can, as Isaiah did, stand up from that repentance, that from humility, mourning over sin, and move forward into godliness, into refreshment, into redemption. And I would encourage you, let us be the people that lead the way so that we repent, so that God would begin to heal our land. Let me pray. Lord, thank you for the Sermon on the Mount. It's a powerful passage. Kind of went super deep into it, Lord, but it's important to understand the perspective in which you teach. The Old Testament correct perspective that Jesus gives, Lord, it's not about the do's and don'ts. It's about the fact that we're all sinners. The beauty is that we can lean into Jesus for righteousness. I pray for that person that's never given their life to Christ, that they would do so now, that they would be poor in spirit and they would mourn, for the kingdom of God would be theirs and they would be comforted in their pain. For the rest of us, Lord, as Christians, allow us to lead the way in repentance, humility, godly sorrow, so that, Lord, you would begin to heal and redeem our land. I pray this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, and all God's people said, God bless you. See you next Sunday as we tackle the next few verses of Matthew chapter 5.